pricing.
That's an impression.
If you remember, we had said that we are now going to optimize theta on two factors. First, minimizing the sum of squared errors or sum of residual, sum of squares of residuals. The second term is that we want thetas to be small.
Can anyone quickly tell me why we want theta to be small? It reduces overfitting.
And what is the expression that we have written over here? What does this imply? What does this mean? What is this mathematical operation?
Norm 1, right?
Yeah. So we are saying the L1 norm of theta is less than or equal to some quantity S. We said that using KKT conditions, the following two forms are exactly equivalent, where delta square is a non-negative quantity as you would expect it. But we also know that the L1 norm of theta of any vector x is not differentiable. So this was the reason why we had a small amount of discussion on something known as subgradients. Right. So we cannot directly set this entire expression to zero and evaluate the optimal theta as we did for unregularized regression or for bridge regression. We saw some sample data set.
Can you see the square under the lines? Better now or too dark?
So what we see is that we see the contour for the L1 norm of theta to be equal to 3, and we see the solution for the unregularized regression, right? And we see that as we keep on changing mu, so mu is now 1.25, and the left-hand side is showing the fit, the right-hand side is showing the solution. So the solution to the constraint problem is where these two contours will intersect, and that we see is currently for theta not to be very close to zero, right? So the intercept term is tending towards zero in this case. As we keep on increasing mu or the penalty coefficient, we see at this point that it has become theta not equal to exactly zero. So we have already got a sparser solution this way. We keep on increasing mu, the squares will keep on decreasing in magnitude. Right, as expected, thetas will start tending towards zero. We also discussed very quickly why Lasso gives us sparsity. We discussed two intuitions. One was the geometric interpretation that L1 norm is more pointed than L2 norm, and LP norm where P is between 0 and 1 is even more pointed. So the probability of intersecting one of the axes increases. Thus, you get a sparser solution where the solution lies on one of the axes. The second method was we took help of gradient descent. We saw that with the L1 norm, the update that we have or the decrease in magnitude of theta that we have is constant. Whereas for the L2 norm, the decrease is initially quick, but the decrease keeps on reducing over time because it's a factor of theta itself. So with ridge regression like problems, our solutions with high amount of penalty will tend towards zero, but not become zero exactly. We saw the notion of regularization path. As you keep on increasing the value of mu or the regularization penalty or the penalty coefficient, many of these coefficients will start tending towards zero, exactly zero, which is the reason why we call this whole solution as a sparse solution. And because of the notion of sparsity and many of the coefficients or features becoming zero, Lasso inherently gives us feature selection. So all the features for which the coefficients are not zero turn out to be the more important features. We discussed the notion of subgradient, where we said that we define the subgradient based for a differentiable by replacing a function fx by a family of functions gx which intersect fx at x0, the point at which we want to compute the gradient at for fx, but it's not computable. And we look at the slopes of all possible gx. So if we look at fx equal to mod x, at x equal to 0, fx does not have gradient defined. But the subgradient will lie in the range of minus 1 to 1, because if you look at all possible gx which lie below or on fx, you will see lines belonging to lines such as y equal to x and lines such as y equal to minus x. We then quickly did something known as coordinate descent, where we said that it is another optimization method. And the key idea is that the optimization, joint optimization over multiple dimensions of coordinates can be hard. You do the optimization one coordinate at a time by fixing the other dimensions. So this turns out to be 1D optimization. We saw an example. We start off again with some initial theta. We choose a dimension. Let's say we choose j equal to 1 dimension. We find the optimal along this particular line, which turns out to be this. The optimal means where the contour is the least. Then we change the dimension and we look at the next line. We again see where the contour will be lowest on this 1D line. And similarly, we keep on going, as we keep on doing like 4 iterations, we tend towards the global minimum. We said that we could pick the next coordinate either using round robin fashion, or we could just be randomly picking up the coordinates. We worked through an example also. And if you see this example, we just move one coordinate at a time rather than multiple coordinates, and we tend towards the global optima over time, over multiple iterations.
Can anyone quickly tell me one advantage of coordinate descent over the regular gradient descent? Yes? Okay, it's comparatively easy because in one dimension. Okay, anything else? What is one of the main points of gradient descent?
Step size.
You don't require a step size. You don't need a step size. We saw a case where gradient descent failed, so we stopped at this point last time. Where we need to optimize jointly, or we need to take steps together in multiple dimensions and multiple coordinates to get to the global optima. If we just do coordinate descent, we'll be stuck at this point. Okay, so I'd request all of you to take out your notebooks and work through this problem with me. So we're going to be using coordinate descent to solve the case for unregularized regression. This is a plain old vanilla linear regression, right? So firstly, we're going to express yi hat, which I'm going to now write in t dimensions. So I'm just going to write it as an expression of d-dimensional x. I'm doing it explicitly because coordinate descent requires what? It requires optimization for one particular dimension, right? So that is why it's useful to write yi hat in this form, summation theta j xi j, where xi tells the ith sample and j tells the dimension, right? So can you write it this way? Theta naught is theta I of 0 for all I is typically set to 1, right? So thus, the theta naught becomes intercept. Right? Does everyone follow it now? So can you write the yi hat expression in this format? And thus you can write epsilon I as yi minus yi hat, which is yi minus summation j equal to 0 to d theta j xi j. Right? So the next thing we'll do is to again write the objective function, which is summation epsilon I squared from I equal to 1 to n, over n points. So previously what we did was calculate the error for one point, right? Ith point. We repeat the same exercise for n points. So we have another summation. And this expression you can thus write as I equal to 1 through n, yi minus y hat of I, right? So using both of these, using this equation, can you tell me the gradient of the objective with respect to a dj dimension? So del RSS by del theta j. Can you calculate that? So again, the same set of expressions you've been doing again and again, but this is going to be a slightly different formula.
Okay, who has the answer? Does anyone have the answer? It's not a very complicated problem, right? You have to find the derivative with respect to. So we have done the same thing when we were doing gradient descent. Nothing. Sorry? Two? Okay. So let's do the first step. Can you write it in this way? You take the 2 out firstly because you first differentiate this with respect to theta. You take 2 out, you write this entire expression once, and then you carry out the differentiation of this inside expression without the square terms. So the only term containing theta j is plus theta j xij here. Right? Can everyone follow please? Yes. So the coefficient of this term is, so there is a minus sign also. So this becomes minus xij, right? So we're going to now rearrange the terms in some fashion. So can we also equivalently write it in the following way? I take out the theta j xij term from here. I take that term out, right? So there is a theta j xij term over here, right? And I take this term out and I just multiply it explicitly, right? So we'll then get 2 terms in the expression. Do you see that? No? Right? Easy, right? So you take out this term theta j xij, you multiply with minus xij, and there was also a minus sign over here. So you get plus 2 times summation theta j xij the whole squared. And this expression is minus xij multiplied by this. So can you tell me something that you can tell about this particular expression on the left hand side? What does this expression tell you? Is it y I hat? Or no? Is it y I hat or no? So this particular expression, theta naught xi 0 plus till dot dot theta d xi till theta. Yeah. So it is not yi hat, but is it yi hat with the jth term missing? Right? Can we say it that way? So we are going to call this term as yi hat minus j. So minus j means that the jth dimension has been removed from the yi hat expression, right? This is just a terminology we are introducing. This particular expression contains everything except for the theta j xij term, right? So we then set the del RSS theta j by del theta j equal to 0. We have this term which we are now going to call as yi hat minus j, right? Everyone following? Yi hat minus j. And so basically you have to set this entire thing to 0, right? So the 2 and 2 get cancelled out. The theta j term is what you compute. This whole expression will be on the LHS, and the xij square term will be in the denominator with the summation. Right, do you follow? We set it to 0. So we get xij squared in the denominator, and this is yi minus yi hat of minus j. Right? So we're going to call this entire expression as
rho j by z j. We are again introducing two more terms, rho and z, where rho j is defined as summation for all points I equal to 1 through n, xij times yi minus yi hat minus j. Right?
Does everyone follow?
And zj is summation I equal to 1 through n, xij the whole squared. Right? So can you tell me what intuitively zj means? The numerator and the denominator should have different summations, but all are over.
Yeah, they should have different summations.
But both of them are overripe. So ideally, I should not have noted. So consider two different summations.
So this expression, the numerator expression seems to be wrong.
This first expression, theta j, is wrong, but these two, rho of j and z of j.
So what can you tell me about zj? What does it tell me?
What is summation I equal to 1 through n, xij the whole squared?
L2 of 1.
Okay, so first tell me, what is xij tell you? What is xij?
Ith sample, jth feature, right?
And if you do it over all n, that tells you, so you're basically calculating xj squared, so sum of squares of all the entries in the jth column.
Right? You see that?
So thus, this is telling us the square of the L2 norm of the jth feature. Right?
So you have different columns, j columns. So j is one of the columns where you have columns going from 1 to d, total d columns.
And for the jth column, you calculate the zj factor, which is just the square of the L2 norm,
right?
And the rho j factor is something like xij yi minus yi hat minus j,
right?
Okay, can you tell me something about rho j? What do you think this represents?
Or what could be an intuitive understanding of rho j?
Okay, let's consider the, consider the case where theta j is an important parameter, right?
So let's assume that you are given d columns. For each of them, you have a theta naught to d, theta d coefficients. Many of them are not so important. With Lasso-like solution, they're all maybe tend to zero, but theta j is an important term.
So what can you then say about rho j?
If theta j is important, what is rho j? So if theta j is important, then rho j should be what? Large or large magnitude? Okay.
So let's try to understand this term. You have rho j equal to I equal to 1 through n, xij yi minus yi hat minus j. Let's plot a scatter plot of these variables. Let's imagine that the data looks like the following. Xij is one of the columns. So imagine now you're doing linear regression, right?
So xij could,
xij is basically the xj column could be, let's say, the number of people in this class.
I could tell you, I could predict the energy of this classroom, and xij tells on the ith day how many people are in this classroom,
right? and yi and yi hat are the ground truth for the energy consumption and the prediction for the energy consumption. Now yi hat minus j is telling me what is the prediction for the energy consumption of this classroom without considering the number of occupants, right? But we intuitively understand that the number of occupants is an important feature for predicting the energy of a classroom, right? Because of the air conditioning cost. So let's try to understand the scatter plot. What this is saying is that as xij increases, so as the number of occupants in this classroom increases, the difference between ground truth and the predicted, where the predicted does not consider this particular feature of number of occupants, increases, right? As the number of occupants increases, the gap in the prediction and the ground truth also increases, which tells me that xij is strongly positively correlated with yi minus yi hat minus j, which tells me what? It's an important factor, and the magnitude and the coefficient has what sign? Coefficient of, so basically theta j, and what can you say about theta j? Will it be positive or negative? Positive, right? From this you can roughly estimate that. That's case number one, where the correlation between xij and yi minus yi hat minus j looks like the following. There could be an equal and opposite, so fairly complementary kind of a case. So xij, tell me some example of classroom energy prediction which I could use, which would have this kind of a behavior. So one feature I could immediately think is minus times the number of people in the class. So that should always work, or one by the number of people in the class. That's a trivial transformation. So what this is saying is that as you increase xij, the difference between yi minus yi minus j keeps on reducing. And think of it as going below zero. Don't think of it becoming zero, close to zero. So this tells me again that there is a strong correlation, although in the negative direction. So jth feature is again important, and its coefficient is going to be negative. The third case is when there is almost zero correlation between these two. So in that case, what can you conclude? So you have some feature like, I don't know, let's say the number of goals scored by Cristiano Ronaldo on the IA day. We're using that feature to predict the energy consumption of the classroom. The correlation is zero, thus it's not an important feature. Theta j will tend towards zero.
Yes. So it might be a case like some feature is showing very positive or negative relation, but might be like no, maybe some other feature which we define that is showing a positive correlation with this thing.
So for all the other features you have already considered in the model. So yi hat minus j, all the features are considered already except for j. And for now consider the trivial case that all of the pertinent features are part of it. So don't consider the case where you're missing out on something, right? So again, this is just for illustrative purposes. So again, don't go behind exhaustive theory for this. Right. So this was it. If you have to use coordinate descent for solving the problem of unregularized regression. So the advantage that we see is you can directly compute theta j as rho j over cj, and what you'll do is you'll keep iterating over the dimension j and you'll keep on updating theta j's, right? Over some time you'll end up with convergence. So convergence could be when the change in magnitude over all j is very small. So while what I'm not talking today and what is still important to do, and I'll leave that as an exercise. So close to convergence, would all of these claims hold true or not that we have discussed? That I want you to think about in your free time. Close to convergence, like the kinds of understanding that we had, that feature is important or positively correlated. Think about these. Will these conclusions still hold true or not? Right. So now let's.
Yes. So if you're close to convergence, let's for now just assume that close to convergence means that YA and YA hat are very close or almost ending to zero. So then you have to think about what happens.
Okay. So I would
ask all of you to take a deep breath because this is even more mathematically rigorous than what we did previously. Thank you. Coordinate descent for Lasso regression. The objective was minimize summation epsilon squared, where epsilon is again yi minus yi hat plus delta squared times the L1 norm of theta,
where the L1 norm of theta could be written as modulus of theta naught plus modulus of dot dot till modulus of theta j plus modulus of theta d, right? Where you have d plus 1 dimensions. So does everyone follow that del by del theta j of the last objective is minus 2 rho j plus 2 theta j zj plus del square del by del theta j of modulus of theta j?
Do you follow this?
So if you don't follow, go back to this particular derivation. What is this particular term? So yi minus yi hat minus j, and this is theta j zj, right? So we computed the derivative. This was 2 times rho j minus xij plus 2 times theta j zj, right? That's exactly what we have written here. Minus 2 rho j plus 2 theta j cj plus del squared del by del theta j of absolute value of theta j. Now the absolute value of theta j is not differentiable at all points. Thus, we are going to make use of subgradient.
So we'll define three different zones. If theta j greater than 0, then del by del theta j of modulus of theta j is 1. If it is less than 0, then this expression is minus 1.
Otherwise, we compute the subgradient, which lies between minus 1 and 1. Right?
Okay, can you make use of all of these facts
and compute the update equations for theta j for coordinate design for Lasso regression? So same procedure what we did previously, but now you have to do for Lasso regression. You have all the tools required on this particular slide.
The trick would be for look at different values of theta j.
Create three different ranges of theta j's, and based on that, tell me the update rule for theta j
in terms of rho j, zj, and other parameters.
Subgradient at 0 is defined in the range. So that's where the effect will come. Just hold on. So think more. I'll show this. So basically, what will end up happening is just to answer your question. For some values of rho j, for some function of rho j, theta j will become zero in some range. So that is what you need to. That is what you need to compute. Theta j is given by some relation for some particular values in some range, and for some values, some function of rho j, it becomes zero. That is where the sparsity will also come. Another hint, you want to write something like if some function of rho is above a certain threshold or below a certain threshold, then theta j is this. Otherwise theta j is 0, otherwise theta j is nothing. That's how you want to write in a form of an expression. Okay, can all of you just look at the projector for the screen for a second? So consider the first trivial case where theta j is greater than 0. So if theta j is greater than 0, then del by del theta j of modulus of theta j is 1. So then you write the whole expression as 2 rho j plus 2 theta j zj plus del square equal to 0. Or you write theta j equal to rho j minus del square by 2. Divided by zj, right? But then you said that theta j is greater than 0, which means that rho j is, if theta j is greater than 0, then rho j is greater than del square by 2. So can you then come up with the condition if rho j is greater than del square by 2, theta j is rho j minus del square by 2 divided by zj, right? Can you write the similar condition for theta j less than 0? It should follow pretty much from the same principle. Yeah, what is the condition f? If theta j less than del squared by 2 or minus del squared by 2? Minus del squared by 2. The case 2 is theta j is less than 0. So it should have been minus del squared by 2, right? Right, so theta j is equal to rho j plus del squared by 2 by zj. But this only if we set that theta j less than 0. Thus rho j has to be less than minus del squared by 2. Right, there should be a minus sign here which is missing. What can you say about the case 3 now without actually solving it? You have seen two extreme cases. If it lies between minus del squared by 2 and del squared by 2, then? 32? Has everyone been able to solve the third case?
So you have seen del rho j greater than del squared by 2. In that case, you write theta j equal to this whole expression. If rho j is less than del squared by 2, you write theta j equal to rho j plus del squared by 2 divided by zj. The third case is rho j equal to 0. Thus, the whole objective is, this is going to be lying between minus 2 rho j minus del squared and minus 2 rho j plus del squared. So, we are effectively going to write that if minus del squared by 2 is less than or equal to rho j, is less than del squared by 2, then set theta j equal to 0. Right? So, we have seen three cases. And if you have to summarize these three cases, we can write rho j equal to rho j, theta j equal to rho j plus del squared by 2 if rho j is less than minus del squared by 2, equal to 0 if minus del squared by 2 is less than equal to rho j is less than equal to del squared by 2, and rho j minus del squared by 2 by zj if rho j greater than del squared by 2. Right? So, a lot of equations, lot of mathematics. Can anyone tell me any interpretation of these three lines, these three equations? What exactly is happening? So, we started this whole discussion about we wanted regularization for solving the problem of overfitting, for which we said that we would prefer smaller thetas, and we know that lasso leads to smaller thetas, and in fact leads to sparsity where some of the thetas tend to zero. So with all that background and these three equations, can you draw some interconnect between them and tell me what the relationship?
If the correlation is less than some range, we don't consider those and make them like the theta j will be zero.
Correlation. So is this a correlation term?
Okay.
Rho j and?
Rho j we considered was the correlation.
Rho j is not the correlation. Okay. So rho j is
minus that by.
Right. Rho j is in something
correlation.
So if that correlation is not like greater than 2
square by 2 or less than
minus
that.
Right.
We don't consider
that. Right. Good. So what is there is correct. Let's visually look at the same thing again. So this whole thing is also known as soft thresholding, because you put a soft threshold on theta j to be 0 if rho j lies between these minus del squared by 2 and plus del squared by 2. So let's plot, and I'm going to now write it as theta j hat because it's the estimate of theta j. So I've plotted theta j hat versus rho j. I'm going to now plot the different cases. So if the first thing I plotted is theta j hat equal to rho j line, right? Just a straight fit line. Secondly, I'm going to plot theta j hat is 0 if minus del squared by 2, if rho j belongs to minus del squared by 2 to plus del squared by 2. So if rho j is between this range, theta j hat is set to be 0, right? If it is greater than 0, it is less than, rho j is minus, less than minus del squared by 2, I write rho j plus del squared by 2 divided by zj. So it's going to be a line parallel to theta j hat equal to rho j, but there's going to be a difference of del squared by 2 units or some normalization constant attached to it. So, and in the third case, we're going to see another line parallel to theta j hat equal to rho j, right? So what we have seen is, right? So what we are effectively seeing is that for rho j belonging to this particular range, minus del squared by 2 to del squared by 2, we set the coefficient directly to be 0. For other rho j's, we set the coefficient to be lesser than rho j, right? So it's reduced by some constant, some offset factor in the positive direction also, in the negative direction also.
Why is it reduced? It can be
greater than rho j. So if it were to follow this particular line, theta at j equal to rho j, it's always below that curve. So just give me one more minute and I'll explain. So let's look at the case of regularization with no regularization, which means that the delta squared term is tending towards 0.
So then theta hat j you will get is just corresponding to rho j, right? You just look at this expression. If delta is tending towards zero, then theta hat j is rho j.
An expression, right?
So that is what we were getting as the estimate for the jth parameter, jth coordinate, for coordinate descent for the case of unregularized regression. For the case of regularized regression, firstly we say that there is an element of sparsity. Whenever the rho j is within a certain range, we set it to zero. But even if there is no sparsity, we tend to do some shrinking. So the parameters tend to be smaller in magnitude as compared to what they would have been in the case there is no regularization. So that is yet another interpretation of why Lasso leads to sparsity and how this entire expression works. So all of these are best demonstrated if you work through some examples and you make some visuals. I think that is where some better understanding will come. Any questions till now?